blessed, and we thank you this morning for the opportunity that we have to come before you and to worship you, Lord. So this morning, we welcome you here. Lord, we ask that your presence will continue in this place among these people, and Lord, that we would just have a spirit that is filled to full and overflow. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Good morning. So let me get this out of the way real quick. You can have a seat if you want and store up that energy for our worship and song in just a minute. There is a whole lot going on, in case you haven't noticed. I'm looking this morning and I'm like, wow, there's just thing after thing after thing in here. And so make sure you're reading your bulletin. Stop out and on the way out the sanctuary doors. That's our sign-up boards. There's some more information out there. There's just way too much to try to convey and convey it adequately. So I just wanted to let everybody know and make sure you're looking at that. One correction we do have, the caravan kickoff, there'll be some more information. It's going to be November. We'll just skip like this too. August 21st, but it's going to be at 6 p.m. That way, the whole family is invited to this kickoff. We're pretty excited. We're looking forward to some more children this year. And so it's at 6 o'clock, and then caravan will actually start at 7. So if you're coming for the hot dog roast, you want to do that at 6. And I just wanted to make sure we'll get that corrected for you as well. Everything else, you should have enough information. If it sparks any questions, we'd love to receive your calls in the office and answer questions. It's always more personal to do that anyway. So we encourage that as well. The one thing that really did not make the bulletin that I wanted to fill you in on, we had a couple people, Ed and I, on Thursday night. Ed and I spent some time talking with some kindergarten parents, and then, going into kindergarten. And then Friday, Jackie and I and Ben had an opportunity to speak with a lot of parents, and there was a lot of interest in Good News Club. And it was nice to be able this year to meet the families first and explain, and we got to see a lot of the students that were last year, and they're all coming back. So that was a really good opportunity. But what I really realized is, I know I've been saying all summer long, you know, there's plenty of places for you to help, and we do need some more people. But I thought, if all these people show up that we've talked to and that are sort of expressing interest, then we definitely need some more help. And the nice thing about the Good News Club, you don't just have to help on that Tuesday at the school. There's a lot that can be done behind the scenes. So what I've done, I'll be more specific later, but for right now, I've just put a sign-up sheet. It's on the top of the sign-up board, and it just merely says I'm interested in some more information, and I would like to be able to sit down, one of us that's involved, give you some more information, let you know what's available, what you could do to help, and then we'll actually have a more formal meeting once we've got in place the spots we need for sure, and then sort of maybe get a commitment from some of you who are willing to help. But last year was really a learning year for us, so we had some people that have volunteered, and I know they probably felt like they didn't get to do a whole lot. That's strictly because we really had no clue what we were doing, but we think we're a little bit more ahead of the game, and this year we'll be able to tweak some things that fit our needs well, and so hopefully we'll be able to present that a lot better and give you better opportunity to fit into that. So if you're interested, no commitment, this is the part that you just want to know more information, put your name and phone number down. I'd be happy to call and talk with you about that. So other than that, I think that it's good. The lift group that is normally at the Travis's home is going to be at our home tonight. So, and we'll be there to host that. I'll be here at church. So feel free, if you haven't joined a lift group yet, you got those three choices: our home, Charlene Chevalier's, and the church conference room over there. We'd be happy to have all of you, and we'll figure out how to fit you all in. So don't let that's at 6 o'clock tonight. We'd love to do that.
Sing with us.
who we can stand on when we need to go to prayer. That should, we were talking this morning, that should be our first defense, is to go to Him in prayer and say, Lord, what do you want? What do you want from us today? And He's going to say, I want you. I want your heart. I want your love. I want your life. And then He's going to say, it's precious. It's amazing, right? It's amazing grace that we can't even explain. And so this morning, as we go to prayer, I just want you to remember, we can raise our hands to Him. We can say, yes, Lord, I need you. And you know what? There's several of us not here this morning who could be doing that as well. They're where they're at, saying, Lord, I need you. And so as we go to prayer, let's remember, it's okay. It's okay to remember ourselves, but let's remember others. And let's remember that, you know, we have a greater purpose than being in this building this morning. And our greater purpose is to be outside this building with the love that we are being filled with by the Holy Spirit and by our fellowship with each other. So this isn't where it ends today. This is only where it begins today. So remember that as we go to prayer, as we settle our hearts before Him, and as we just get real and honest, we just let the Lord know that we are so thankful for your love this morning. The amazing love, Lord, that you give to us, not because we deserve it, not because we've done all the right things, not because we've said all the right things or done, gone all the right places, Lord, but because you've chosen to love us with a kind of love that we'll never be able to understand, no matter how long we search for it, Lord. Every time that we come before you, there's something new that we learn about you. We learn that you are not just a good God, you are a great God. You are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, Lord, which puts you in a place that we can't even imagine with our minds, Lord, let alone with our hearts. And Lord, when we begin to take that in, when we begin to say, Lord, we need you, that's when you really begin to work in us. And so as you begin that work in us today, Lord, for each and every one of us that raised our hands in this building, Lord, we just pray that you would have us empty ourselves of all those worries, of all those fears, of all those concerns, Lord, of all that negative talk in our mind, in our life, and you would just enable us to sit a while in your love, to sit a while in your power, Lord, that you've promised to give to those of us who are walking with you, those of us who have said, my life is no longer mine, it's yours. Lord, we've got a power that we've not even begun to tap into, because if we did, there would be change everywhere. So, Lord, we pray that you would help us. Help us, Lord, to live that kind of love, live that kind of power, not for ourselves, but for those outside, Lord, those who need to know that. And there's plenty of them out there. Lord, there's a whole harvest ready to be reaped, Lord. And you're saying, where are my workers? Come to me. Come spend time with me. Lord, I pray that you would heal every person here this morning that's dealing and battling with illness, fatigue. Lord, whatever it is, you're able to energize, you're able to heal. And Lord, for those that aren't with us this morning because they're not feeling well, Lord, we pray that your touch right now, it would go beyond this building as it already is, Lord, that they would just know this morning that they are being lifted up in prayer. Lord, may they see you as they've never seen you before. May today be a day where they say, I have been with the Lord regardless of where my physical position is. I have spent time with the Lord, and I am forever, ever grateful. Lord, we pray that you would help us to continue to build our lives on that very foundation, on Jesus Christ, our Savior. Lord, we'll never be the same. We know that. We accept that. Lord, we welcome that challenge. We pray that you would give us a boldness, that you would give us a love for you and a love for others this morning. Lord, this morning, part of that love is us giving back to you what you've blessed us with, Lord, it doesn't have to be blessings by the millions. It can be blessings, Lord, just by what seems meager in our eyes. What we think we're barely able to make, Lord, you said, no, I will bless even that if you are faithful to me. If you will give to me your offering, your tithe, I will give in abundance to you back. And it's not, Lord, necessarily a monetary thing. It's a blessing of obedience for what we can do for you. So, Lord, we count that a blessing. We count that a privilege. So this morning as we give, we pray, Lord, that you would help us to give out of that obedience to you, out of that love for you. May you use this as an expression, Lord, of how we mean it. Lord, may you bless it. May you bless your kingdom. And may your will be done, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know that summer is the season when most of the church, really most of the people, decide to travel. Did you know that? Most people decide to travel during the summer. I imagine it has something to do with the school year. But it just happens that way. And I've noticed that this summer has been one of those summers when a lot of people have been traveling. Probably some of you did some traveling over this past summer. Yeah, that's why we spent so many weeks talking about vacation. I know some of you thought that I was getting ready to go on vacation. I was talking about vacation so much. Right? And we figured that if we're going to stay motivated toward doing what God is calling us to do, then we probably needed to understand what vacation should look like for those of us who are followers of Christ. That was the whole purpose of that series. So Barb and I, we did some traveling too. We spent most, or at least a lot, of July working with the district youth ministries. First we went to Phoenix, where we hung out with about 9,000 other Nazarenes at a thing called NYC, Nazarene Youth Conference. That was all about learning and worship, and we got together so that we could be motivated, and then we were sent out to bless the city of Phoenix. Then we came home and we spent a week at Fruitland Park, Florida. That's over by Leesburg, if you're not sure where that is. And we enjoyed a week of our annual Sacred Life Teen Camp, which also includes our NYI convention. NYI convention is always kind of the pinnacle of NYI, Nazarene Youth International. That's our teen ministry. And this year it was especially something for me. I don't know what. This was the year that I turned over the presidency to somebody else and have stepped away from that job, that position. I don't know what that's going to look like. I just know that it was time and God was pushing me to do what I did. So we had some great times this July with all of our students and those who work in that ministry. These events were incredible. And all of those who attended them had the opportunity to be challenged to live a life dedicated to and transformed by Jesus Christ. That was really the main point, right? That we would all grow closer in our faith and that we would all understand the transforming power only found through Christ Jesus. Since our return, I felt a strong urge to share from the theme of NYC. That theme was love God, love others, live love. And I shared from the idea of love God just a couple weeks ago. Some of you were here, maybe most of you were here. So this week, I want to focus on the thought of love others. Love others. We spent a lot of time before going to NYC learning and reciting the Shema. I'm not going to put any of you on the spot. But is anybody here that you think you could probably recite the Shema? Okay, that was good. I saw a couple hands. Our Wednesday groups, both our adults and our students, our teens, we did a study on what it says and how it can be applied to the way we live. The Shema comes out of Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. Let me read it to you. It says this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. This is a passage of Scripture that is very important to every Jewish child to commit to memory. They actually recite this every morning and every evening as a way of remembering or reminding themselves how important God is to them as a nation and as a tribe. When I wrote that sentence, I thought, wow, America could learn something about that. I find this fact intriguing because I'm not sure many Christians can say the same thing about the way they start and finish their day. Don't answer this out loud, but can you honestly say you start your day and you finish your day with thoughts of praise on your lips and on your mind toward Jesus Christ? See, they can say that. Do you start and finish your day that way, every day? So, there are some elements in the Shema that I want us to look at this morning. But, I want us to look at a passage from Mark chapter 12 instead of the Deuteronomy passage. Would that be okay? Good. Mark chapter 12, Jesus is presenting the Shema to one of the teachers of the law. Now, that seems kind of silly. The teacher of the law, obviously a Jewish man in this day, right? So they probably know the Shema. But Jesus is presenting it to him. And so let me invite you to stand in honor and reverence to the Word of God as I read from Mark chapter 12, starting in verse 28. It says this: "One of the scribes came and heard them arguing, and recognizing that he had answered them well, he asked them, 'What commandment is the foremost of all?' Jesus answered, 'The foremost is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these.' The scribe said to him, 'Right, teacher, you have truly stated that he is one, and there is no one else besides him. And to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, and with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as himself, is much more than all burnt offerings and sacrifices.' When Jesus saw that he had answered intelligently, he said to him, 'You're not far from the kingdom of God.' After that, no one would venture to ask him any more questions." This is the word of the Lord. Let me pray. Lord God, I thank you that we can come into this place again and worship you. I thank you, Lord, that your word speaks into our hearts. I thank you, Lord, that you are the one that we praise, and as we praise you, you inhabit our praises, and you fall on us in a spiritual way that enlivens our soul and gives us reason to go and do more. So today, Lord, I pray that you would hide me in the shadow of your cross, that every word I speak would be from you, and Lord, that you would go and protect every ear that hears, just in case I say something out of turn, that they would only hear what you have for them, Lord. I pray, Lord, that they would receive and that I would receive exactly what you have for us today. And help us to go from this place challenged and changed. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Let's take a few minutes this morning to consider what's actually happening as Mark records this story. If you take the time to look back at the way Mark records his gospel, you quickly see that Jesus has just returned to Jerusalem for the last time. Yes, that's important that you get it. The last time. You see, he's on his way to the cross, and he seems to be unreserved in his conversation. In other words, he has resolved to go and do what he came to this earth to do, and he has set his face towards that end. You ever get so determined on something that you're just set, and it doesn't matter who says what or what's going on, your reaction always has to do with where you're going. You ever get that way? I get that way almost every Sunday morning. Anybody tries to talk to me on Sunday morning, and I'm usually like focused back on the sermon or on what we're playing, or it just all comes together. I get that way almost every Sunday morning. If you talk to Barb, my wife, she would tell you I get that way all the time. I'm pretty much a one direction person. When I'm on it, I'm on it. When I'm not, man, I'm a mess. I just tell you, it's the truth. So Jesus is set. He knows where he's going. He's headed to the cross. And so in Mark's telling, Jesus enters Jerusalem and goes to the temple where he chases out the people who are selling things that they shouldn't be selling there for the reasons that they're selling. These actions then bring many people who want to question Jesus. And often their focus or their purpose is that they want to try to catch him saying something that they can use against him in court if they need to later. Right? Jesus is taking these questions head on. There's no holds barred. He's not holding back. He's taking these questions head on when he's approached by the scribe, the teacher of the law, with today's question. Have you ever had someone seem to be drilling you for information? I know, nobody really wants to admit that. Have you ever experienced a time when someone was trying to get you to admit something or at least say something that might condemn you, even though you were innocent of whatever it was they were trying to pin on you? See, I'm not asking you to lie about this, so I don't really want you to speak out if you're not sure. But if you've experienced this kind of drilling, this kind of being raked over the coals, this kind of trying to figure out a way to catch you in something, then you have a good idea about how this probably felt for Jesus. This is kind of where he was. He knows where he's going. He knows his purpose. He knows what he has to do to get there. And all these people are trying to catch him in a lie. So when the scribe comes to him and asks, what's the greatest or the most important commandment? Jesus is probably a little bit relieved. I mean, this is an easy question, right? You know, Jesus was Jewish. He grew up like every other Jewish child grew up, reciting the Shema. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength. But Jesus didn't end with that. Not in this cup. See, he takes it a step further. He says, the second is this. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. Why do you think he does that? You see, that's what I was wondering. Why didn't he leave it at the Shema? He took it a step further. When we look at the Shema, we see that God is always supposed to be first. He is Lord, and that means everything else comes after him. Tough word in there is everything else. He is Lord. Everything else comes after him. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul, right? So I guess I got those mixed up, I'm sorry. But he's saying everything. That pretty much covers everything. But when Jesus says the second is like the first, he takes this to the next level. I mean, now he takes this elevation of God to the people on the street. You realize that? I mean, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and your neighbor as yourself. And even though everyone knows they're supposed to take care of other people, they're pretty hesitant to admit what that means. You can say ouch, Pastor. Yeah. Let me just take you there, okay? I hear this all the time about how the church is only in existence to take your money, right? When you talk to people that are not in the church, they talk about, oh yeah, I know, you go to church and they go on all your money. And no one likes to hear a sermon about money. And no one likes to hear a preacher get up and tell them that they need to give more money. And no one wants to be a part of a church, or any organization for that matter, that's always asking for money. And because of this, we don't really focus on giving very often in the church today. But when Jesus says that we are to love our neighbor as ourselves, he's actually saying that we are to put the needs of others above our own desires, and even above our own needs. That's tough. I feel like I'm a pretty selfish man when I start to talk about what this passage means. I'll be honest. I enjoy having nice things, living in a comfortable place. I enjoy that. Sometimes, maybe too much. You see, he's referring to the things that you can't do without. Right? He's telling all of us that we should be giving to help everyone we can. He's saying that we need to move ourselves down a few notches so that we can begin to bless others who are in need. If you don't think I know what I'm talking about, or if you think I'm wrong, read on in your Bible in Mark. Because Mark doesn't stop with this story. You see, he continues to talk about what it costs to follow as we're supposed to be following him. And he ends with a story about a widow who puts the last of her money, which isn't much, into the offering at church. Now, she's actually preparing for death. And that's another sermon altogether, so we're not going to go there. But it makes sense that these stories follow each other. You see, Jesus is on his way to the cross, where he's going to give all of himself as a sacrifice for us. I know. I've said that a few times. Maybe you're understanding why. It's important that you get it. He's on his way to the cross, and he's going to give everything he has. Everything he has. For you and for me. Make this personal. He did. And he runs into these people who want to know what it takes to follow him. He answers them in words they will understand by sharing the Shema and then adding to give everything you can to help others who are in need. And then he shares what he sees a lady who has nothing give to the Lord through her offering to her church. I see this as a pretty intense way of telling us what it looks like when we truly love others. Now I realize this is a church and she's giving to a church. I'm not saying you have to give all your money to the church. I'm saying we need to let go and let God show us where we need to give what. It might be money. It might be time. That's something that's really tough for me. Right? It might be your favorite, I don't know, whatever you have. Look at Ephesians chapter 5. I'm going to read quite a bit. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 20. In my Bible, this section is entitled, Be Imitators of God. I thought that was interesting. It says this, Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love, just as Christ also loved you, and gave himself up for you, an offering and a sacrifice to God as a fragrant aroma. But immorality or any impurity or greed must not even be named among you, as is proper among saints. And there must be no filthiness and silly talk or coarse jesting, which is not fitting, but rather giving of thanks. For this you know with certainty, that no immoral or impure person or covetous man who is an idolater has an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore, do not be partakers with them. For you were formerly darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the light consists in all goodness and righteousness and truth, trying to learn what is pleasing to the Lord. Do not participate in the unfruitful deeds of darkness, but instead, even expose them. For it is disgraceful even to speak of the things which are done by them in secret. But all things become visible when they are exposed by the light. And everything that becomes visible is light. For this reason it says, "Awake, sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Therefore, I love the therefore. That's always a big word. It says, get ready. Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise men, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation. But be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody with your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks for all things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to God, even the Father. Now, I know that's a lot, but this is the instructions that tell us how to live. And when we're focusing on what Jesus is telling us to do, as we try to understand what it means to love God and to love others, it makes sense that we try to understand how we are expected to live as followers of Jesus. I honestly think that this is one of those things that the church often drops these days. Because I really believe that we are supposed to live a certain way. But when we start talking about how everybody should live, somebody gets offended. And when somebody gets offended, then they end up leaving the church and somebody else gets mad because they left. And you know what I'm talking about. But there are things that we should do or be or live because we follow Christ. And if you talk to Pastor Barb or myself, and every time somebody asks us this, I don't know, at least a couple times a month, well, what is your favorite book to read in the Scripture? Barb's always Ephesians. I have two. I go back and forth. Ephesians and Galatians. And the truth is, both of them talk about how we are to walk with Christ. They are giving instruction on how we live. So Jesus said to love our neighbor and ourselves. And the Apostle Paul tells us that we are to be imitators of Christ. What does that say to us? Is there a challenge in these words? I think of it this way. Do you have a hero or an idol? Again, don't talk. Just do you have a hero or an idol? You know, someone that you would be drawn to, you would like to be like, you would at least maybe you'd like to experience some of the things that they live or that they seem to be living. Can anybody relate to that? Just do this. Do it so subtly so nobody knows what you're doing.
Yeah, I'm
See, I've known a lot of starstruck people over the years. I don't know why I was never really a starstruck person, but I've known a lot of people that have been starstruck. People who get super excited about meeting a rock star, or a movie star, or a well-known athlete. Maybe for you, this would be the president, or some other diplomat. Or maybe some famous preacher. I'm thinking like David Jeremiah, John MacArthur, John Maxwell, or maybe even Stephen Furtick. All really well-known preachers. People tend to try to reach goals based on something that someone else has accomplished. Or maybe something that someone else has tried to do but wasn't quite able to achieve. These attempts are measured by how close they can come to doing what they're attempting to do. I know I've always had a secret ambition to be a rock star. It's true. I started out wanting to be a drummer because I love to beat on things. And then I realized that the guitar player gets to come out front and really jam, right? So I changed my desire to become a lead guitarist. As you could tell, I never accomplished either one of those things. Growing up in the 70s and 80s gave me a lot of superstars to idolize. And I did more than my share of wanting to be like some of them. That's what I believe Paul is telling his readers to grasp. See, that's what I think he's saying. He's saying for us to strive to be like Jesus. Like that. Try to be like Jesus. He's the one who will always supply what we need. He's the one who will always draw us to be better, more complete people, who, by the way, will bless others. And he's the one who will make us different in the right ways. I spent most of my life different. I've always kind of prided myself on being different. When, you know, when they came out with the picture that had the, I think it was a fish going the wrong way with the whole school, I was always that guy. I'll give a little bit of my age. I remember my first poster in my bedroom. Some of you will know it. Most of you will know it. It had a guy who was kind of small, but he had his foot out like this, right? And he said, "Don't tread on me." Yep. He was on his way. He was going. That was one of the first things I ever did. I was just different. I liked setting the tone rather than following the crowd. Sometimes I set the tone and I marched to my own beat because nobody else followed. It happens, right? But Jesus is the one who will always make different the right way. And will eventually find that he molds us into his image in a way that gives us power to live as he created us to live. So in conclusion, if we want to learn to love others as Christ has asked us to love them, then we will have to be willing to be transformed in his image. And for that to happen, we'll have to be willing to change some of the things that we hold tight in our fists. This is tough. But here's what I know. When we loosen our grasp on the things we think are important in our lives, and we begin to receive what Jesus is replacing them with, we find ourselves loving in a brand new way. And that love always starts by elevating God to his rightful place in our lives. We actually do make him Lord of ourselves. He becomes Lord. So as the band comes, I want you to think about what it means to make him Lord. Because once that happens, we find ourselves loving other people in ways we didn't really think we could. We find ourselves putting other people ahead of ourselves. We find ourselves actually going out of our way to bless somebody else. Will you please stand with me? If God is calling you today to lay something or many things down, if He's calling you to lay something down today, will you come to one of these altars and lay it down through prayer? Just give it to God and let Him take it. Will you do that? I believe that CCNAS is on the move. I believe that we're growing. I believe that God wants to do amazing things in us and through us. And I believe He's going to use us to help transform this community. I believe that. So, as we follow God's lead, we need to know that He's got big plans for us. I just want to know, will you follow the movement?
Thank you.
come to you now, thanking you and praising you for all that you are. Help us, Lord, to put our trust in you, knowing that we will not be shaken. We will not lose. We will not fall away if we trust and follow you. Help us, God, to realize that we need to give more to you. We need to follow you better. We need to be more like you. Help us, Lord, to be imitators of Christ and not just going through the motions. Lord God, fill us with your Spirit. Fill us fresh and new, and send us out to go and do something